Okay, well, I did say that I had our visitors, our regular solicitors here in the studio, the third Thursday of the month, and normally there's two, this week there's three. Okay, so let's say hello. First of all, let's say hi to Michelle. How are you doing?
Fine, thanks, John.
Jolly good. And also to Max. Are you fine?
I'm fine, thank you as well, John. Thank you.
And then, of course, there's Paul, who's usually here on the afternoon. How are you doing, Paul? All right?
Very well, thank you, John. Good to be back.
Yeah, good. It's good to see you and so on. Take it you're all busy down there, as usual.
It's been pretty hectic. There's I think a lot of things cracking off, as I hope we can explain shortly. But it's been a particularly busy time of year, this August, yeah.
I see. OK, let's start with Michelle, because you're looking at doing a marathon. So what's that all about? Half marathon. It's a long way, you know.
It is, John. I work for a local charity, Living Without Abuse. We offer support, advice and advocacy to anyone suffering domestic abuse. We work in northwest Leicestershire, so we're out there in the local communities helping people. As head of fundraising, I have to raise funds for the charity, and I've come up with the Donington Park Half Marathon.
I see.
It will be the first time that a half marathon has ever been ran on this iconic racetrack. It's on Sunday, the 23rd of November. We're really, really pleased and think we're really lucky that we are working in partnership with quality solicitors Manda Cruikshank, who are kindly sponsoring this event. Manda Cruikshank are very supportive with domestic abuse and the services in this area, so really pleased to be in partnership with them.
Yeah, I mean, if I can ask a straight question, are we seeing that domestic abuse is rising, or is just my perception of it? You know, am I right?
Unfortunately, it is rising. Yes.
Yeah, and yes. I think some of it is related to money and things like that. You know, as we have less spending money in our pocket, do you think that's responsible for some of it?
Yes, I think it is. I think it's general day-to-day life in today's world. It is very, very stressful. Finances do have an impact. There is a lot of issues around domestic abuse which do heighten the issue.
I see. So the way forward, really, get some money so that we can get some support and hopefully get everything back under control, really, with this.
That's right. So, that's right. So I've organised this Donington Park Half Marathon.
How do you go about organising a marathon?
Oh, good question, actually. Very good question. I'm a casual runner.
Yeah, okay.
And I'm not a member of a running club, never ran a half marathon, and I just felt, why not organise a half marathon? There is you look out on the streets, there's a lot of people running for fitness. Running clubs, there is quite a lot around in the area, so decided to organise a half marathon, did quite a bit of in-depth reading to find out the legal side of things and regulations, and met with Donington Park.
And they're on the site.
23rd of November, and there it is.
That's absolutely great as well. So this will be just one lap, will it, round the circuit?
No, the half marathon is 5.5 laps.
5.5?
Yes, it is a UKA measured course, so it is an official half marathon distance. As well as the half marathon, there is a corporate team relay baton challenge. If a half marathon's too far, why not get a team of five together? Four will run one lap, which is approximately 2.5 miles. The fifth will run 1.5 laps. Medals for all finishers. Yeah. If you're a young child, why not do the one lap fun run? That's open from age 10 upwards.
Okay, so you're putting in different teams from different organisations over the area, or?
Yes, we can put in different teams, or you can enter on your own if you're up to that 13.1 miles.
I see. Do you know, one thing about events like this, and I know there's a serious side to it because it's all about supporting living without abuse, but the good team building days, if you work for a company, you probably never see each other socially, if you see what I mean. Must happen, I'm sure, is down at the solicitors, the same as it happens everywhere else. So they're good team building days, aren't they?
It's fantastic. Yes, it's fantastic for the teams. It encourages companies to raise money for charity, etc., etc. And you normally find on these type of events, you enter a team once, you get hooked and want to enter again the next year, hopefully.
Okay. And you being a regular runner, of course, yourself, how many times do you run a week then? Every day? Or?
No, I try to run two or three times a week.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But not too far, just purely for fitness, to keep the bones moving.
Okay, well, I'm sure it's good enough. Right, let's just turn our attention then to Max. Hey, you running, Max?
No, John. My knees are terrible.
Look, is this an excuse or what?
Paul is gradually putting my arm at my back to try and persuade me to run a lap. So I'm sure after more heavy negotiation, we may come to some arrangement.
So the entry level was a one lap, is it? That's the entry level?
That would appear to be it. But I've said to him, I'll do the lap if he does a lap and a half at the end. But we'll see.
So how many laps are you doing then, Paul?
Well, there's a few of my department that are putting their names forward, and they keep on suggesting on a daily basis I ought to be joining in with the relay. So I would happily lead from the front and do the first lap.
Okay, well, that's good sporting of you, I tell you. Okay. Well, can I wish you all the best with that, Michelle? I'm sure you're doing a very nice thing there as well. And let's hope. If anybody wants to put a team together, what do they do? Get hold of you down at Quality Solicitors, Manda Cruikshank?
There are leaflets here.
Yep,
downstairs. In the cafe, there are leaflets at Quality Manda Cruikshank, or alternatively, if they want to go on the website, it's www.donington-park-half.co.uk.
Yeah, just repeat that again, it's www.donington-park-half. .co.uk.
That's correct.
That's all right on
you
that.
You said
one.
It better than me.
Okay, just remind you that we're talking to our three solicitors that are with us today from Quality Solicitors Manda Cruikshank here in Colville on Beaver Road. Well, let's talk to Max now. Max, now we have a new department, I believe, which is supporting people with legal representation on mental health. Is that right?
That is right. Yes, it is the new mental health department, and what we do is we try and help people who are being treated under the psychiatric system and for one reason or another have had some of their rights, which you and I might take for granted, removed from them. Commonly, of course, it's when somebody's being detained in hospital against their will. But we also deal with things like people who want to manage their own financial affairs and aren't allowed to, or want to be able to make representations about the sort of medication, the sort of treatment that they receive.
Must be very specialist, this type of thing.
It is. I've not checked the figures recently, but the last time I checked, you have to have a specific qualification, which is you have to be a member of the Mental Health Review Tribunal Accreditation Panel. And last time I checked, and there will be more now, but there were 299 people who had that accreditation in the United Kingdom. So it is quite a specialist area.
I see. So it sort of links between the health side of things and the law side of things. So you need people who have got experience in both of those areas.
Yeah, I mean, I am a solicitor. I keep saying to my clients, look, I'm not a doctor. You know, ask them.
Okay.
But you do have, when you go for the accreditation process, you do have to have some parts of the questions that you're asked and parts of the training that you have is about mental health, medication, diagnoses, that sort of thing, without going into too much detail.
I see. Okay. And this type of thing, is it really common that you do get people in hospital and they do need legal representation, really, because of the situation they find themselves in?
Yeah, I mean, there are two types of people who are in hospital. There are those who are there voluntarily, who very often don't need our help, but regrettably and very sadly, there are quite a lot of people in hospital at any given time who are being detained under the Mental Health Act, so detained under section, who don't want to be there. They want to get out, and that's where myself and people like me come in.
I see. Okay, so is this quite, is it something that's unique, or is it something that you could find if you went to Scotland or even to Cornwall or whatever, is it something that's across the UK, or are you guys
We are, yes, if you went somewhere and you were detained in a hospital, no matter where you were in the UK, you would find a local solicitor who would do that sort of work. There are what we call advice deserts in certain areas, and Wales particularly suffers from an advice desert. But if you are detained in hospital and you do want legal help, then all you need to do is ask the staff on the ward, the nurses on the ward, for the, something called the solicitor's list. And they'll give you that, and that's the list of all the solicitors that would provide this sort of service.
What type of service? I see. Okay, and your office, is it in Colville? Is it?
Yes, I'm in the same office as Paul, up on Beaver Road. So
if anybody wanted to use these services, do they contact you in just the normal way, or does it have to come through a third party?
No, they can ring us up in the normal way. We have a specialist phone number, and I have forgotten the specialist phone number, but I'm sure Paul hasn't.
He'll know exactly what
I'm sure he will, yes. We have a specialist phone number that will get you through to the mental health department, and it's best to ring that rather than the normal switchboard number.
And whatever you say, of course, is in confidence.
Oh, absolutely. As all things are. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know the number, Paul?
Yeah, please.
I'm afraid you've set me up to fail on that.
That's all right.
No, if people want to inquire about it, contact the Colville office in the usual way, and we can provide details of who can provide the support, the direct number for the department, and also email addresses and the like. We also have information on our Facebook page as well about it, so just please feel free to drop me a line in the usual way.
Okay, and the on Facebook then, is it just looking for Quality Solicitors Manda Cruikshank? Is that the...
Yes, or just type in QS Manders, M-A-N-D-E-R-S, QS Manders, will take you directly through to our Facebook page.
Yeah, do you know, funnily enough, people that have lived in Colville all their life, they still call you Manda Cruikshank. you're going to be 20 years at least living that down, I think. So they could go. But that's the way it goes, doesn't it, in rural life. You must be pleased with some of the new ideas then, Paul, that you've got, you know,
very new facilities. Yeah,
some
of these have been quite a long time in the making. I mean, I originally spoke to Max about 14 or 16 months ago about the possibility of providing further legal aid services to the community. I think it's very important because in many areas the services being provided by high street solicitors, local people that know the area, live in the area, are being decimated, and what we're trying to do at Quality Solicitors Manda Cruikshank is to increase the number of services that we actually provide, which can be provided on a free of charge basis when required by anybody within the local area. So I'm quite proud to be able to say that we're increasing our knowledge base, increasing the skills. Max is an extremely experienced solicitor who also works within the crime department, provides some criminal services. A very positive positive step forward, and we're pleased to continue helping to support the local community.
Yeah, of course, you tend not to realise, but you need a different type of solicitor, all depending upon what the problem is, don't you, really?
It's amazing how many people will say, oh, Paul, but whilst you're sorting this problem out, can you please draft me a will and help me transfer the house? Well, I specialise in crime, and if you asked me to draft your will, I wouldn't know where to start. It's important to have a lawyer that is specialised in what they do. It can be very difficult to be experienced in more than one area. Is it better to know a lot about a little or a little about a lot? You need to pick the right person, and if you need any help with that, then just drop us a line and we can direct you to somebody that can help.
Yeah, I see. Okay, well, it's been great talking to you. Anything else from you today, Wallaby?
I was hoping just to briefly mention a little bit about holidaying abroad.
Okay.
I've had a few people ask questions over the last few weeks. Obviously, we're in August and holiday time, about travelling abroad, and it strikes me that whilst there are quite a few people that know not a lot about laws in this country, there are even more that travel abroad to countries who don't know about the laws and customs to where they're going. And what I was just hoping to do is to flag up to people who are still yet to go on their annual holiday or are travelling later on in the year or even next year, about how important it is to make sure that when you're going abroad, particularly bearing in mind many countries have very hefty prison sentences for what in this country would appear very minor crimes, the importance of doing your research and making sure that you don't fall foul of the law abroad, where in some parts of the world you can spend weeks or months detained in custody before a decision on whether or not the investigation is going anywhere or not. I brought some papers with me of some examples to give people, because I think it's important that people realise that what we consider are everyday activities that are perfectly acceptable, such as drinking alcohol, Smoking an e-cigarette are in fact not just abhorrent to people overseas, but are actually criminal offences that can result in periods of imprisonment. For example, I know this isn't necessarily a country that is local to us and frequently travelled to, but the UAE, if you take an e-cigarette there, that's now a criminal offence.
Is it a criminal offence to just take...
To take an e-cigarette.
How did they base that? Did they base it on the, you know, the use of it or the chemical solutions that make them up? Or?
I don't know the exact reasons behind it, but then if you start looking at other countries out in that part of the world, illegal to possess or to drink alcohol in Saudi Arabia, a lot of the activities, going down the pub, having a pint, having a cigarette or an e-cigarette, in many parts of the world, are things that are criminal offences and you can't do. And be it religious reasons, be it cultural reasons, if you're going to a country abroad where it's a criminal offence, you need to know. Otherwise, you can find yourself being detained at the airport, having the items confiscated, or worse. There are some examples of from last year where two British tourists went for a swim in a moat in Tokyo, which sounded may sound like harmless prank and fun, but unfortunately it was a moat belonging to the emperor, and they were arrested 23 days before the investigation concluded whilst they were detained in custody, and it was treated as the equivalent of breaking into Buckingham Palace would be over here. Other examples would be jaywalking, people crossing the road not at a designated space, or offences in the United States, Poland, Czech Republic. And the other thing I wanted just to raise awareness of is travelling abroad in a motor car, making sure that you carry all the right equipment. There are laws on what you must have in a car, be it a fluorescent jacket. In parts of Europe, you must have a fluorescent jacket.
Let's have a little look at this after the news. We are coming up to news time from 3 o'clock. It's a very interesting subject. I've often read things, even in the local press for that matter, where somebody's done something quite innocent, you know, and they've not come home for the next 3 or 4 weeks, just waiting to, you know, either get some representation and get them back home. OK, let's go up to the news and we'll chat about this in a minute. It sounds very important to me. OK, we're talking to Paul just before the news, and we're talking about things that can really go wrong when you're on holiday in another country. Paul, if we can just pick up on what we were chatting about. We were talking about Holiday Inn and the various things that can go wrong. I've read in the newspapers many a time that there's been a person who's gone on quite an innocent holiday, really, and got mixed up in something that they shouldn't have done, and next thing you know, they've got a long wait over there. In other words, not catching the plane back. So it's quite common, is it?
I think having a long wait to come back would typically involve drug cases. Certainly ones that we see on the news would tend to be people who've been involved in either possession of what we would consider to be Class A or B drugs, or possession with intent to supply, or the trafficking of drugs. And certainly, as listeners will know, in some countries, trafficking of drugs is punishable by death. So certainly in the most extreme cases, and thankfully there are usually a handful of these every year, and not more than that, you can not come back to the UK if you get involved in certain things like that. But what I wanted to try and draw people's attention to is the more common problems. For example, just travelling abroad by car to, say, France or Spain or Monaco, whereby there are laws that are peculiar to those countries that we might not necessarily consider. And this is particularly important from a financial point of view, because in France, for example, they have what's known as an on-the-spot fine or deposit, where typically they can be up to €750 for transgressions of what we would consider to be fairly minor road traffic offences. And clearly over here we don't have fixed penalty notices of €750 or that would be about £600. So minor problems can be very, very expensive indeed. I mean, for example, in a built-up area in France, the use of the car horn is absolutely prohibited unless there is immediate danger. So, for example, just hooting the horn to let somebody out, or to you know, suggest to a pedestrian that they're free to cross the street in front of you, or if there's no immediate danger, can land you with a stiff penalty in France. There are many other examples of people travelling to France not appreciating the differences. Take drink driving. The drink drive limits are different. They are lower on the continent than in the UK. If you are used to perhaps drinking a pint and thinking in 20 minutes' time you'll be safe to drive, well, you may not be in France. Don't take the risk. The use of dipped headlights on motorcycles, for example, if you're travelling abroad on a motorcycle, it's compulsory during the daytime to have your dipped headlight on a motorcycle. It's not in the UK. So there are numerous examples of situations whereby you could innocently find yourself being stopped by the gendarmerie for what would seem an innocent mistake, but they wouldn't see it like that. It's their laws, it's their country, and you have to abide by them.
And, you know, you reminded me of something some years ago, and this is something that happened to me. I was over in Spain, and I hired a motor scooter, and I was going to travel from the Benidorm area into the next village. And it was quite ironical, really, because I was told by the operators that you don't need a crash helmet, you don't have to wear one, and I set off on my journey. I went over a set of crossroads, like anybody else would, where you just simply motor across the crossroads. I got stopped when I went onto the road, and I was told that I had to pay a fixed penalty fine because I didn't have a crash helmet on when I went across the crossroads. But it was certainly right that the two roads that I were travelling on either side, I didn't wear a crash helmet. I didn't need one either. So my offence was travelling along that road without a crash helmet.
Yeah, of course, this is a problem where by frequently people will say to me, when even in this country they've committed a moving road traffic offence, well, so-and-so told me that. When you're a driver of the vehicle, you are in charge. You are solely responsible for that vehicle, for the safety of the vehicle and the safety of the passengers. It's really, really important that you know exactly what you were doing when you were driving in that country. Yeah. I mean, in France, for example, sometimes you have to give priority to vehicles coming in from the right. We don't have that situation in this country, whereby a particular sign is shown and you actually have to act in a different way from what you would normally do. So you really must know the laws of the roads to travel abroad. And as I was saying earlier, the importance of particularly travelling by aircraft to further afield countries, of knowing their customs, cultures and laws as well. I've got just an example here I'd like to share with you, if I may, John, time. One that I picked out when I was looking for something that's quite frankly, in my view, bizarre. My son, for example, has some clothing which is camouflage. It makes him look like an army man. And you'd think that's perfectly fine wherever you go in the world. Well, let's take Barbados, for example. It is a criminal offence for anyone, including children, to dress in camouflage clothing.
Really?
Now, if you booked your flight to Barbados and you weren't aware of that, check your suitcase, because if you've packed your child's favourite camouflage hoodie top, you will be committing a criminal offence and, of course, liable for a hefty fine. There are laws that, again, in countries such as Cyprus, taking photographs in certain areas, such as near military establishments, is extremely problematic. And perhaps a more known about one in France, and this would apply to people of certain faiths, obviously it's illegal to cover your face.
Yes.
It's also illegal to force somebody to hide their face by a fine of up to €30,000 or 12 months imprisonment. And if you force a child to hide their face, the sentence is doubled.
I see.
So if you're travelling abroad, please, please do your research. There are plenty of places you can find information. The government have a website. It's www.gov.uk, whereby they give foreign travel advice. The AA have a website with information. But most importantly, also cross-reference and check the information is up to date. In doing a little bit of research for today's show, I came across numerous references to you having to have a breathalyzer on your person when you're travelling in France, because the French were introducing a law that required you to keep a breathalyzer on you at all times so that you can check whether or not you're over the limit or not before driving. Well, whilst there's a lot of information out there saying that you have to do that, in fact that law still hasn't been enacted. It's been delayed and looks like it's now not going to come in at all. So not all that the information out there is accurate. Of course, if you have any questions or concerns, you know where to come.
That's right. Can I just ask you one serious question, really? You do often read in the paper that people will say that they had been approached by somebody at the airport to carry something which is illegal. In fact, we are carrying a public service announcement on the station at the moment, which implies that a person is at the airport and they've been asked to carry something which is illegal, probably drugs and things like that. If that ever happened to you, what is the immediate action that you should take? You obviously don't want to do it, so what would you do? Just turn around and say no, or do you go somewhere specific to report this?
It's difficult to give comprehensive advice because obviously the circumstances could change from case to case. Obviously if somebody's approached and is put under pressure, perhaps threatened, either with, say for example, a knife, or threatened that harm would come to them, it can be very much more difficult to be able to deal with the situation. Clearly if somebody just casually approaches you and asks you to carry their bag through, even if they are somebody you know, even if perhaps you've known them for a few weeks or even a friend, you ought to take responsibility and check that item. And if they're a friend of yours, they ought to accept that checking the item is just for your own security, and just to make sure that you're satisfied that everything is legitimate, particularly if travelling abroad to a country where something like an e-cigarette is a criminal offence, because something that is innocuous in this country, of course, can land you in a great deal of trouble. So nobody that's a friend should be upset if you ask just to check what's in the bag before you carry it through. But if somebody that you don't know approaches you, or if you put under force or pressure, coercion to say walk through airport security with something that doesn't belong to, then my suggestion would be that as you approach the security officers, you quietly and discreetly declare it to them. Something like, please note this bag has been given to me, I've been asked and demanded to take this through, I've been threatened, it's the gentleman that's over there in the red top, please can you help me? And of course, if you are open and upfront about it in a discreet way, there are mechanisms that the airport security staff can put in place to offer you the relevant support and security to make sure that that you're looked after. Never ever walk through, act as if nothing's wrong, and then try and unpick what happens afterwards, because it will just lead to a disaster.
Yeah, indeed. Serious stuff.
Indeed.
Okay. Paul, thanks for that.
Thank
always
you, John.
Always good to chat to you. Always got a good subject. So there we go. Nice information. Well, can I say thanks for coming in, all of you, this afternoon. Good to see you.
Thanks for having us, John.
And
we have found
we've got
the
a
number.
Telephone number. Yeah, when I can find the card. Yeah, this is for the mental health legal advice. The telephone number is 0333. So that's 0333-2029321. That's right.
That's right.
That's 0333-2029321. Just one other point, and that is all 03 numbers, they are part of your normal contract. In other words, they're charged at the same rate as you pay for 01 or 02 numbers here in the UK. That's right.
That is correct. Thank you.
Good to talk to you. Thanks then. Bye bye.
Thank you very much, John.
Bye bye.
Bye.
There we are, quality solicitors, Manda Cruikshank, and some good advice there. They're down on Beaver Road here in Colville.